I wish to truly thank Magda Yacoub for involving me in this initiative, and I'm honored to be here and to share some thoughts with you. I am a simple clinical cardiologist, so don't expect from me any answer to any complicated question on markers. However, I think that if you really want to go into the translational era, it's the clinicians that need to ask the questions and maybe address new pathways for research. So this is what I will try to do in the next 20 minutes. So we know that there may be random errors in our genetic code and that this may affect the cardiovascular system by producing phenotypes, which eventually turn into clinical problems. And the phenotypes may vary from dysfunction to hypertrophy to electrical phenotypes. But we know that the actual truth is much more complicated than this. And that we know that there are a number of genes that can, just by single mutations, give rise to complicated diseases. And that this is only a small fraction of what we know and are beginning to understand about the pathogenesis of genetic heart disease. However, the problem is that in the genetic era, so before the genomic era, before the epigenetic, we have had the temptation of taking shortcuts, of making things a bit too simple, because we had found the gene, found the mutation, and so, you know, all of a sudden we thought we had the key to understanding complicated diseases. In a way that is too simple. Albert Einstein once said, things should be made as easy as possible, as simple as possible, but not one bit simpler. So we need to keep that in mind. One of the concepts that has been held a long time, and we heard Franco Cecchi talking about the revisitation of cardiomyopathy classification, is that the mutations in the genes, for some reason, remain dormant because most of these patients are born without a phenotype. Most of the patients with genetic mutations in cardiovascular genes are born without a phenotype. So the concept lies that the gene lies dormant until a prince wakes the monster up rather than the princess, and the disease all of a sudden explodes and the phenotype is born. However, this is, again, too simple. Let's take a couple of examples. For example, Marfan syndrome. We know a lot about Marfan syndrome now. It is a complicated disease. Obviously, a lot of enthusiasm was spurred by the discovery that Marfan was linked to a mutation in fibrillin 1. Well, that's great. This is a matrix component. It's a structural gene. You have a mutation there. The matrix is weaker. You have, you know, plenty of reasons to explain the acquired phenotype, so all the vascular problems that these patients encounter had a clear explanation. However, there are many things that are not explained by this simple theory in Marfan. For example, long bone overgrowth. How does that relate to simply a weakness of the matrix? And in fact, it turned out that the story was much more difficult to understand, much more complicated. Fibrillin 1 is a key factor in regulating TGF-beta in the matrix. And this is a molecule which is involved in a number, an impressive number of very complicated pathways, including, for example, growth. So that even and the interaction between the fibrillin 1 gene and TGF-beta, and obviously the similar disease can be caused by TGF-beta 2 receptor mutations. So this disease has underpinnings which go before birth. In a recent report of a working group that is reported here, the authors specifically state that the developmental underpinnings of apparently acquired phenotypes should be explored. So the story, the phenotype, is born much before the individual is born. Again, there was a recent paper on right ventricular arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathy. We'll hear more about this by Professor Tiene and Cristina Basso, I'm sure. But this is an interesting paper in which the fibroadipose tissue that is replacing the myocardium turns out possibly not to be simply adipocytes standing there and just stepping in as the myocardial tissue is lost. It turns out that these may actually be cells which are committed to adipogenesis very early in development because of the direct consequences of nuclear plakoglobulin mutation. So something that was explained very simply, fibrofatty replacement is in fact something that is a developmental consequence of the originating mutation. So that is interesting. And again, we know that in isolated left ventricular non-compaction, whether you believe this is a separate entity or not, Professor Rapezzi will talk about this, but we know that non-compaction is related to proepicardial dysfunction, perturbation in proepicardial function. So again, a phenotype that is born in a prenatal era. So let's move to hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, which is the main topic of my talk. Again, here we have a phenotype, which is asymmetrical hypertrophy, unexplained hypertrophy. And in the early 90s, as we heard Professor Cechi say, there was identification of mutations in sarcomere genes. So that's perfect. It's fantastic. You have the engine of the heart, which is actually mutated, and it's not working properly, so hypertrophy steps out as a compensatory mechanism for this. That's perfect. You don't really need to do a lot of thinking, just that's all we need. Well, in fact, again, the story is much more complicated than this. If you go and look at the phenotype into the most intimate details, this is a complex disease. Hypertrophy may or may not be there. It may be massive, may be mild, and it's not related sometimes to the severity of the disease. However, you have disarray, which is not easy to explain, just based on sarcomere mutations. You have fibrosis. You have extensive remodeling of the microvasculature, which is composed of fibroblasts and smooth cells, smooth muscle cells. And these cell types, fibroblasts, smooth cells, these do not contain the genes that are mutated. These do not contain beta-myosin, do not express the proteins that are mutated in HCM. So how do you explain such a vast variety of abnormalities in a disease that is simply a cardiomyocyte disease? Again, you have marked abnormalities of the mitral valve. The mitral valve is abnormal in this disease. And the mitral valve does not contain, in the leaflet, does not contain the mutated proteins. And you have areas of non-compaction. So the story must be more complicated. For example, this is data that we recently put together with the help of Martin Mehren, was the principal investigator here. These are data from Boston and Minneapolis patients at Tufts, and studied by magnetic resonance. If you measure the leaflets, and magnetic resonance allows you to do this, in patients with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, and you compare the length of the leaflets with match controls who are normal, you can see that the leaflets are always very markedly elongated, so that the valve is abnormally long, abnormally large in HCM patients, and this bears no relationship to the age or degree of hypertrophy or the presence of obstruction. So it's a totally primary component of the disease, which is unrelated to other mechanical or morphologic factors. It has to be a primary component of the disease. You can see this even in very small children. And this, again, points to something happening very early during development of the heart. This is not something that seems to be acquired. And we have beautifully heard about the proepicardium from Dr. Brandt. So this saves me a lot of pain in trying to explain what the proepicardium is, which is difficult for me. However, it is very intriguing to know that there are cells which colonize the heart, and with single cell types give rise to fibroblasts, to the coronary circulation, to smooth muscle cells, so that by interfering with a single mechanism at this level here during development, you can easily explain all the variety of abnormalities that are usually observed in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So it is intriguing to speculate. We don't have any data, but to speculate that there may be interference between the proepicardial migration and colonization of the heart and what we actually see in a full-fledged phenotype of HCM. We have seen what the proepicardial organ does, so I will not spend more time into going into this. And let me just Let me just show you what we postulated in this viewpoint, which we recently published with Magdi Yacoub. So if we speculate that for some reason, epicardioidized cells, at the time of colonization of the heart, when they covered the heart and then colonized the heart, creating the skeletal, the fibrous skeleton of the heart, the microvasculature, the coronary vessels, and actually giving the architecture to the heart. Well, if this is for some reason interfered with, well, instead of having normal coronary arteries, you may well have coronary microvascular remodeling, which we observe in ACM. Instead of having normal valves, and by the way, the pericardium gives rise to the atrioventricular valves, not to the aortic valve, for example. So this will explain why the aortic valve is normal in ACM, but not the mitral valve. Then you can well explain mitral valve abnormalities, which are a fundamental key factor in determining obstruction in patients. If you have interference with the formation of the fibroskeleton of the heart, this would well explain the fibrosis and the disarray. And also, I mean, there's this thing that the epicardium gives rise to Purkinje fibers, and this is something that is totally unexplored, but this may well be one of the reasons. And again, I'm speculating here, no data, but it's interesting to speculate that may be one of the reasons why the disease is more arrhythmogenic than others. Why? Why should on Earth the proepicardial cells be abnormally should receive an interference by the sarcomere mutations? We know that these cells are normal. I mean, the proepicardial cells are normal. It's the sarcomere, it's the cardiomyocyte cells that are not normal in this disease. And they are contracting abnormally. They are abnormally contracting right from the beginning, right from the heart tube stage. We know that these mutations, as Heba beautifully told us before, these cells sometimes contract too little or too much, depending on whether the mutation is gain of function or loss of function. So you may well speculate on the fact that these proepicardial cells are colonizing a heart that is not contracting normally. Maybe too much, maybe too little. For example, this is the first mutation discovered by the Seidman group, and in our lab in Florence, Corrado Poggesi's group showed that this is actually a gain of function mutation, so that it's a very fast contracting sarcomere, very fastly contracting cardiomyocytes. So these cells, which are colonizing the heart and trying to give rise to the heart skeleton, to the coronary microvasculature, to the architecture of the heart, are actually confronting with an abnormal contracting environment. And by means of epigenetic mechanisms, we heard about this as well, and mechanotransduction, we know that if the envelope of the cells is abnormally stretched, this has direct consequences on the DNA expression, on genetic expression, because it may actually interfere with histonic mechanisms, with the mechanisms we've heard of in terms of epigenetics. So it may be that an abnormal mechanical stimuli may actually interfere with genetic mechanisms within cells which have no mutations. This is why, potentially why, you may have such a complex phenotype in patients with cardiomyocyte mutations involving cells which are not cardiomyocytes. And last but not least, the proepicardium, at least in the mouse, it's debated whether this happens in the chicken as well, but does provide cardiomyocytes as well. And lo and behold, these cardiomyocytes prevalently localize to the interventricular septum. So again, no data, so don't take this for, I'm not trying to take this point too far, but this could be an explanation why the hypertrophy in these patients is asymmetric and prevalently localized to the interventricular septum. So in conclusion, I think that we need to, actually I'm ahead of time, this is incredible, so should I stop and for coffee? Well, I know, maybe I haven't been clear enough, but maybe I didn't need too much time. Let me just conclude by saying that there is increasing evidence, not only in HCM, but in a variety of diseases, that we should look for phenotypes, for developmental mechanisms which may explain Okay, thanks. Which may explain some aspects of the phenotype which are not clear to us. And we should not stop at looking at what is actually evident in the mature phenotype which is acquired. In hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, the interaction of sarcomere mutation with proepicardial cells might explain what happens to non-cardiomyocyte cell types. And that this obviously needs to be proven and investigated right now. Let me just conclude with a quotation from Lucretius, who is the greatest poet of science. Do not blame the eyes for the faults of the mind. So the things that we don't see, we should look for. Thank you.
So thank you very much, Dr. Olivotto. The paper is open for discussions. There's a question.
Thank you for the nice speculations. If the pro-epicardial organ is responsible essentially for formation of the epicardium, why the epicardium is spared in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy?
Well, that's a very good question. Maybe it's because the epicardium remains outside and it's not exposed to abnormal contraction. That's a short answer, but
I mean, with regard to the TBX18 hypothesis, I just want to make a comment with regard that the TBX18 has been subsequently shown to be actually also expressed in the cardiac myocytes. So probably it's not a very good marker to distinguish the contribution of proepicardial cells to the myocardium. However, there are reports also with a different marker that there is a contribution, but it's not clear how much it is and how important it is. But nonetheless, there's never a clear and final answer, right? One question I have, however, is with regard to your hypothesis of, let's say, an early onset of the disease. Let's say, I mean, are there indications that, let's say, in mouse models of cardiomyopathy, that at birth in a neonatal heart, there are already pathological signs?
Yes, it's very, very rare case reports, but there are reports of... Well, first of all, we do see neonatal... We do see cardiomyopathy in utero as well. Some patients, although rarely, are born with a phenotype. This is rare, but it does occur. And there are reports of autopsy reports of neonatal... Maybe I would ask Professor Tiene to comment on this. Listen, maybe you could you provide your invaluable expertise on this, because...
On the theory of the second heart field in arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy, we have here the embryologist, and so maybe of help. This, we have to distinguish the second heart field from progenitor subepicardial cells. The second heart field is involving the outlet of the heart, the bulbous cordis, the right ventricle. But arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy is anymore a disease only of the right ventricle. It's a biventricular disease, rarely is also a septal disease. So you provided the evidence that the proepicardial cells are involving also myocardium, even in the septum, in the left ventricle, and the interstitium as well. So I think that in arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy, most probably are the progenitor subepicardial cells that are involved in the disease, not in the second heart field. That is my idea.
Have you? What is your experience with neonatal phenotype in familial cardiomyopathies?
What are you referring to? Neonatal phenotype in hypertrophic or arrhythmogenic? You know that the hypertrophic may be present. Indeed, I have observed the cases of neonatal hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, primary hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, sarcomeric one, not the glycogenosis.
Yes.
This is not the case of arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy. I have never seen a case of arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy under the age of 10. So it's a late expression. It's a genetically determined cardiomyopathy with late occurrence, not with neonatal. That is my experience.
Thank you.